Well, we're in for an amazing and possibly a life-changing experience because we have a speaker, a humanitarian, somebody who's led the human potential movement, probably started the human potential movement, I think. Someone who's had connection with so many people in our leadership globally that she truly has a sense of herself that very few people can possibly have with respect to having a global perspective of our world. And so that's an enormous thing right there. So before I introduce her to you, I want to have Carla, Reverend Carla, read to you from the front of your program something Jean wrote about travel and consciousness.
Whole new orders of spirituality are emerging. Not about religion, new cosmologies are giving us a view of ourselves that we've never had before. For the first time ever, we find that we don't live in the universe, but that the universe lives in us. In other words, for the first time in human history, we are consciously aware that our own evolution as a species is in our hands and not left to random choice. That's both wildly exciting and terrifying. Isn't it enough to jump out of bed with passion and enthusiasm? Time to wake up, folks. Fresh organic coffee, lovingly grown in a cooperative, is brewing. To quote our friends at Interaction Associates, ROI equals return in involvement. It doesn't matter whether you get involved in responsible travel, sustainable tourism, green travel, geotourism, etc. What matters is that you participate and take a stand for what you believe in. Dr. Jean Houston.
And it's my great pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Jean Houston.
It is very interesting that you quoted on something I said about travel. I travel a lot. In fact, to date, 108 countries. And I've often, when working with the United Nations and other international agencies, and I do a lot of travel in indigenous societies. And I'd like to begin by telling you a story about a society that I was working on. It was the Polynesian people who live in the center of Taiwan. They had come 1,000 years before and pretty much preserved a fascinating culture. And surrounded by mountains, we were caught in a raging typhoon that seemed to have no end. And we huddled together on the slate floor of the Aboriginal temple while the rain just dripped all around us onto our faces. Great sheets of water coming down from an infinite sky. We were in not just a typhoon, we were in a monsoon and a typhoon simultaneously. You could not see more than 2 inches in front of you because of the sheets of water. Well, lightning illuminated the temple every few seconds, revealing what appeared to be shrunken heads. They were shrunken heads because the society had 50, 60 years before been a shrunken head society, cannibalistic society. And another flash, and there was the carved, horrible effigy of an ancestor, another flash and the mask of a demon. Anyway, on top of that, my stomach was heavy with snake meat, which had been presented to me as a place of honor. And it was a gristly dish baked in poi paste. And we had to eat it. You wouldn't believe some of the things I've had to eat around the world. All I can say is man does not live by bread alone. Anyway, they regaled us with songs and dances, reminiscent of the Polynesian culture in which they come. Well, incessant rain pelted the roof. And in the midst of the nature's great fireworks, our host declared, "There's no point trying to sleep." And his grandmother, who was the spiritual leader of the community, sat beside him, tiny lady, probably about 90, formidable presence, and her quick little hands worked away on her beaded handicraft. And her remarks were translated, "Bring in the teapot. This is a night for stories," she said. And then she took her commanding matriarchal eye toward me. "You must tell us a story from your own land. What kind of story would you like?" Wondering what in the American saga of stories I could possibly tell. And she conferred with her relatives. And at that moment, the storm got wilder, and the door opened, and the battering rain came in, drenching everybody. And she cackled and said, "Tell us a story about a typhoon and doors that open into other worlds." So I thought, The Wizard of Oz. Of course, The Wizard of Oz. And through that long lightning spat at night, huddled together against the storm and the whopping rain, they listened. The Americans reverent before the core story of our culture, interrupting only to sing a song from the movie, and the Chinese and the Aboriginal folks commenting in very comical ways throughout. You know, the witches, good and bad, were well-known figures. The wizard was seen as a Taoist immortal who could fly up to heaven. The lion became a dragon. The scarecrow was assimilated to the favorite folk hero monkey, while little Dorothy was clearly Kuan Yin. And when I finally came to the end, intoning the great words, "There's no place like home," the old lady bit the thread, bringing it to a close. And nature was silent. And they went and opened the door. And we did not see any more rain, but blazing technicolor greeted our eyes, just like in the movie. Remember when Dorothy opens the door? A rendezvous of rainbows, dripping palettes of color from every tree, a world made of myth and magic. And next to me, a very young member of the community attempted a little English. "There's no place like home," she said. "There's no place like home." What a charged and mythic term that is, isn't there? This story, this great myth, and what I'd like to talk about today is the spiritual and psychological dimensions of that story. In fact, I've just finished 2 days ago a book called The Wizard of Us, so I'm sort of on top of the story. Because what you see in The Wizard of Oz is not simply a myth, but a powerful initiatory drama filled with rituals of every kind. Now, rituals are very important. Rituals come from the word rita in Sanskrit, rita, which means art, discipline, the dance, that which illumines our transitions. And we are sorely in need of rituals today. Too often, our notion of ritual is sport, you know, football. The 11 young heroes carrying the holy egg through the womb of the goalpost while the so-called virgins dance and scream on the side. But in The Wizard of Oz, it is a ritual rite of passage for little Dorothy from her home in Kansas through the deep archetypal world of Oz, and with all that she learns there, and a return bright, filled with new knowledge and wisdom back to Kansas, you see. And so she goes home to Kansas, but not before she grows up in Oz, not before she discovers her own world of sufficiency and abundance. She undergoes the great road of challenges that teach her about using the richness of her own intelligence, deep, heartful friendship and compassion, courage. She learns about the genius of teamwork and a committed community can do anything. I'm reminded of the words of my old mentor, and actually I was her adopted daughter. I had a wonderful mother, and she had a wonderful daughter. Her name was Margaret Mead, and she lived with us the last 6 years of her life, off and on. "Never doubt," she said, "never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed," she said, "indeed, it is the only thing that ever has." And of course, what happens through the small group of thoughtful, committed, polyracial beings, a small white girl, the human kingdom, a lion, the animal kingdom, the tin man, the mineral kingdom, and the scarecrow, the vegetable kingdom. Yeah, I mean, it's an utter integration of all types. And together, they change the world. And they discover, finally, the wizard, who's really not much of a wizard, but is a profound and great psychotherapist. Now, let's look at this story in terms of what is really there for us that often we don't see. She lives in an outmoded situation. Nobody was going to help her. Her little dog is about to be snatched up and put to death. And the little dog is the only bright thing in Kansas at that moment, remember? Okay. So she goes to her aunt, Auntie Em, oh, go away, darling, can't you see? We're counting our chickens. The American way of life, you count your chickens. And so she is in a state of profound yearning. How many of you have ever been in a state of profound yearning? Somewhere over the rainbow, the next world over that's waiting for us. And that other world is yearning for her. In the book by Frank Baum, it is a real world, if you remember. In the movie, they make it a dream, but you know, forget about that. Really, it's a real world. So she's in this state of profound yearning. There's something about deep yearning for a larger life that activates the universe, and it begins to get very interested in us. That's all I can say. It's not desire. It's worse than desire. It's yearning. It's really yearning. And so she feels called. And of course, what happens is that there has to be something that is going to shake her up big time. How many of you lived in a state of yearning for too long, but it really took a catastrophe or a crisis or the equivalence of a typhoon to get you moving? But you might want to look at that one anyway. So she's in this outmoded situation. The typhoon comes, she is hit on the head, or she goes into her house, her relatives go underground. She is then taken to a world in which, when the house lands, she opens the door from the black and white, very linear world, that gray world, into this vast world of color and delight and passion and a high civilization, a medieval civilization, with guilds and people who understand teams and clubs. We represent the lollipop league. Remember all that? You know. And part of that has to do with re-experiencing the joy of the senses. Because the more that you activate your inner senses, inner seeing, inner touching, inner tasting, more and more things become possible. I had the great opportunity yesterday working with the 8 to 18-year-old girls, many of you know about. And we worked on that, the activating of the senses. And then putting in your desire, because when you activate internal senses and then put your intention so that your intention becomes filled with life and color and feeling and touch and taste, then things happen. You have stopped boring God, for one thing, you know. And your intentionality takes on profound life. So that's what happens there. And then what happens? The archetype of the soul shows up, Glinda, the good witch. The archetype of the higher guidance, what I call the entelechy. It is the entelechy, it's a Greek word, means dynamic purpose. It is the entelechy of an acorn to be an oak tree. It's the entelechy of a popcorn kernel to be a fully popped entity. It's the entelechy of a baby to be a grown-up human being. It's the entelechy of you and me to be, I assure you, so much more than you ever thought you could be. And that great entelechy figure kisses her. And in the book, it kisses her on the third eye, and that becomes shining. And you should really, if you see the movie, read the book, too. The book is very great. But just put your hands up like this for a moment. And close your eyes, if you would. And I'd like you to imagine that your highest guidance, your Glinda, your high self, the essential you, yourself as if you'd had 1,000 years to really work on yourself. The one who knows you and loves you is right there sitting opposite you and sending you so much knowledge and acknowledgement, cherishes you, nurtures you. You feel yourself nurtured and empowered and so deeply, deeply loved and ignited and quickened on your own spiritual journey of the road of spiritual pollen, and know yourself loved and deeply seen and quickened and empowered and called forth to your higher destiny. You can put your hands down. Normally I would do a much longer invocation, but that's the entelechy. That's the quantum partner. That is that of which you are the exotype, of the archetype, the playing out of space and time, of the immensity of possibilities. So yes, they're set on the yellow brick road, the road of spiritual pollen, and the road of spiritual adventure. And the first person that she runs into is the scarecrow, who complains that he does not have a brain. But interestingly enough, he turns out to be the smartest among them, the one who has the wit and the creativity and the problem solving. Too often I find that people who complain that they haven't got something, often they have it in abundance. It's just that it is so much they dare not look at it. Is that familiar to any of you? Yeah. And so with this massive amount of intelligence, what it took for him was more than just a change of attitude, but a sense that of his own possibilities, because we find that a genuine transformation of consciousness engenders actual structural and chemical changes in the brain that affect those who experience them both psychologically and physiologically. It also changes when you change your mind and your brain about things. It changes the energy frequency around you. Now, I have been very close friends with a number of people who are profoundly lucky. That's all I can say. One of them was Margaret Mead. I never saw anybody so lucky in my whole life. I mean, luck just followed her around. And I said, you know, it's amazing. I've never seen anybody so lucky. She said, yes, I am blessed. But why are you so blessed? Because I expect to be. No, she literally lived like that. And it was amazing. My good friend, Deepak Chopra, everything he touches, you know, seems to resolve, energize, make things happen. Why? He really lives profoundly out of a sort of scientific, mystical sense of the universe and its energies being available, truly available to him and everybody else. It's one of the reasons for his great and deserved popularity. But it is a change of mind. And the experience of the scarecrow is one in which his mind becomes reignited, becomes alive again. Now, one of the things that we now know through my own work and others' work is that the brain changes itself. The brain is not hardwired, as we thought. It is not a complex machine that cannot change. On the contrary, the brain has remarkable capacities for reorganizing, regrowing itself, so if one part fails, another part can pick it up. If there's a death of brain cells, there's a concomitant rebirth of new ones. That circuits can recircuit themselves. My old friend Bruce Lipton has shown that thinking, learning, acting, intending, meditating, praying, enjoying, playing, being joyful can activate profound genetic structures of our bodies and our brains and literally transform ourselves regardless of how old you are. Now, I just had a major birthday, some of you know, last week. I am now 75. I keep saying, this is what 75 looks like, you know. But the whole point, I'm also half Sicilian, so it's 4,000 years of olive oil, you know, so it's actually, it runs in the family. But the fact is, I find because I've had to, because of the nature of my life, I have to stay attentive, learning, thinking, interacting all the time. And hopefully that will allow me to survive much longer and do the work that I do. And I do not boast when I say I live the life of a high-powered 35-year-old woman. And many people think that's how old I am when I go into these cultures where people die at 50, you know, so I have to keep on. But it is not whether you look this way or whether you don't, whether you've got to keep your mind active and it keeps growing. Now, the next person she meets is who? The Tin Man. Mechanized. Yeah, that's part of the mechanization. Now, we could say it's mechanization, now it's technology. All those kids, as I said, with the transcendental thumbs, you know, calloused on, you know, their mobile. Where is the humanity? Are they losing friends? Can friendship just be these huge, huge, you know, almost apocalyptic exchanges of violence or eros? Something has got to be done. We have to put art, as I said yesterday, art back into the curriculum. Yes. Where children are dancing and singing and drumming and being information and not just the abstraction or the use of a thumb. This is very, very, very important. And that's that whole sense of the heartfulness of it all. What does it mean? I mean, I want you, here's an exercise. I want you to close your eyes and I want you to think about someone that you really dearly love. And from your heart to theirs, send love. And then ask them to send love to two others in their life. And then to those two others, to two others, and two others, to two others, and this love, love, love vibration moving out, out, out. And right now, guess what? Everyone in the world is now connected from your heart with love. And really feel that pouring of love that is going out, out, out. And then ask a plant that you know and feel love towards it, a plant, a flower, or whatever, and ask it to send to two others, which it can do in its own strange way, and two others, and two others. And now all the plant world is connected. Now to another kind of being, be it a dog or a cat or an ant or a flea or an elephant, and send that love and ask them to send it to others, and two others, two others. And now our entire planet and all sapient things are connected. And now I ask our planet to send it to others, and they to two others, and they to the others, and to the sun, and the sun to two others, and two others. And this is happening in nanoseconds, and now the entire universe is connected. And now ask our universe to connect with the mind and soul and heart of God. And from the mind and soul and heart of God back to us. And from us to the mind and soul and heart of God. In faith with your breathing, feel this great, great, great flowing of love from you through all creation to the mind and heart of God. And from the mind and heart of God back to you. And how are you? And how are you? And you feel this? Yes. And then, of course, there is the one, the cowardly lion, who seems to lack courage. And it's so interesting about that. You have to read stories of courage, you know. You have to know that you've made it to this point in your life. You couldn't have done it without courage. We're living in the most complicated times in human history. Other times in history thought they were it. They're wrong. This is it. This is it. It's a profound job to be here. Because we don't have the safety of the small tribe or the small expectations. We have massive opportunities. And for most of us, such attributes as compassion and courage are revealed in times of great adversity. And those are times when we're tested to see what we're made of. And we find out much more about our moral compass when we're given a situation in which we must stand up for ourselves or for others, stand up to the bully at the school, stand up to the authority of bureaucracy, stand up for those who are less fortunate, being a voice of hope where there is no voice speaking out. I think of Julia Butterfly Hill, who's known for living in a 180-foot-tall, 1,500-year-old California redwood for an amazing 738 days to prevent the loggers of the Pacific Lumber Company from cutting it down. And she said, real courage is the space when the ordinary becomes extraordinary. It exists when any person faces fears and insecurities and chooses to act it anyway. And if you remember the story our friend the Cowardly Lion, facing and overcoming fears and insecurity is proof that you've got the nerve. You dare to be. You have the courage to be. And he's often fearful. He's often fearful. It doesn't mean that fear goes away. It means, because it's an ancient thing coded in the old brain, but it means the courage to risk and dare to be continues. And that's what happens. So he's the one who faces down all kinds of things, doesn't he? Okay. And then, of course, they get on that road. What a wonderful scene of the great team dancing down the road. And then they immediately fall asleep because the bad witch sends, you know, the snow, the poisonous snow. And this is a very, very important part because too often, and it has happened in my life, I wonder how often it's happened in your life, where you are nearly there with what you want to do, and then for some reason you fall asleep, or you withdraw, or you lose your spunk and vim and vigor. And that's what you really need. A group of friends to say to you, wake up! Don't go back to sleep! Wake up. Wake up. Or if you're in a period of depression, I know some people in northern India that when they know they're going to go into a downer, they say to their friends, will you be God for me for 3 months? Yes, I'll be God for you for 3 months. Right, God? I will hold your excellence while you go there. And then when you come back, I'll give you back your excellence. Very important. And then, of course, they do wake up. And they get, finally, you know, they get cleansed, the wash up. It's that time in which we ritually reboot ourselves, get ourselves cleansed of old thoughts, old toxic habits. Stop taking a PhD in our own pathologies. Again, stop boring God, you know. And when they finally get to the wizard, they are given an impossible task, aren't they? How many of you have ever been given an impossible task? Or you've taken one on? Yes? Three people? Come on. How many of you have? So what do? They do the impossible. Flying monkeys, I mean everything. People who are marching with great Russian things. Oh, or whatever they're singing, okay. And they get into the, and this is the kind of thing. Now, the reason I bring this up is, friends, we have lived through the good times. We're now in the great times. Because I have a lot of information about the world, I am very worried about the next few years. And this is the time where you really get your friends together. You empower each other. You call each other forth in greatness as we go through the next few years, you know, whether it's economic or ecological or both. And I don't mean to scare you. I think Jason is saying something that we all know. That what's happening in Europe, we see what's happening now. But we are being honed to our purpose, our destiny, and our higher humanity. And of course, that's what happens in that extraordinary story. And when they are being raced through and all these closing doors into that castle, the witch's dark castle of night, and finally she brings the torch to torch. Who? The scarecrow. And Dorothy, with tremendous courage, picks up the pail of water and throws it on that. It hits the witch. The water of life dissolves her. And that is the courage and love and the passion for the possible. And I will do it in spite of everything that seems to be going against it. That's when you hone your pluck and cunning and you really come together with who and what you truly, truly are. And then they finally, finally get back to the wizard. Remember the great mime? There he is pulling gears and little Toto has pulled back. Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. Remember that? Because often that which you fear is the man behind the curtain who really isn't real. And everybody has seen him in all his undignified poses, pulling the gears, shouting. and looking found out. And Dorothy marches up to him and says, "You're a very bad man." "No, my dear," he insists, "I am a very good man. I'm just a very bad wizard." Well, the scarecrow makes, you know, demands the man make good on his promise to send Dorothy home, to give the tin man a heart, to give the lion courage, to give himself a brain. "Well, you've had them all the time," the man says. "You promised us real things, a real brain, a real heart, real courage." And then an incredible thing happens. The wizard, now in human clothing, smiles, seems wise, his eloquence says, "Boys, you've been aiming low. You not only surprised, but you greeted me." And he says to the scarecrow, "Anybody can have a brain. That's a mediocre commodity. Every pusillanimous creature that crawls on the earth or slinks through the slimy seas has a brain. What you need is a certificate, diploma." And he declares it gives him, you remember, "Here I give on you, by virtue of my authority, investigating me by the Universitatis Comitium e Pluribus Unum, I hereby confer upon you the honorary degree of Ph.D., Doctor of Thinkology." And of course, the birthday, if you remember, the scarecrow's brain swells with happiness, and he thanks the wizard profusely. And he says similar things to the lion. "You, my friend, are you're a victim of disorganized thinking. You're under the unfortunate illusion that simply because you run away from danger, you have no courage. You're confusing courage with wisdom, you know. What you haven't got is a medal." Gets the medal. And Tin Man, "As for you, my galvanized friend, you want a heart. You don't know how lucky you are not to have one. Hearts will never be practical until they can be made unbreakable." And he gives him a testimonial, you see. Now, what would they, and then of course with little Dorothy. "Well, I could take you home in a balloon, that's how I got here," in Kansas. But of course what happens is that the balloon takes off and she has to find out. As Glinda, the great, great guidance, says, it was always there to go home. You close your eyes. And you click your red shoes 3 times and say, "There's no Mesa." And then they arrive. And what they arrive, where they arrive, is that it's that marvelous scene where it's almost like the scene of Renaissance painting, where all the characters now as normal human beings are around her. It's like a Renaissance breeze. And she says, "It was always in my own backyard." Backyard, the collective unconscious of the human race that is ours to live in, to be in, that we are storied beings, that we contain in us vast, vast, vast treasure houses of wisdom, heart, brain, intelligence, courage, archetypal friends, wizardry. The wizard is us. So she has undergone adventures that have helped her discover the riches and uses of her own intelligence, the opening of the heart, friendship, compassion, the courage that comes of taking risks and meeting all challenges. She has learned about magic, wizardry, the sacred potency that is contained within each of us. And she now not only accepts these deepened aspects of herself, she appreciates them. And she has returned home to Kansas to re-green the wasteland with her newfound knowings. Do you see? She is ready and able to co-create a beautiful new world that works for all of us. So you see in this great story how profound, how perfect, how potent are its images. Go back and watch it again, and watch it as a journey of transformation filled with wisdom messages that are just for you. Because the Wizard of Oz, my friend, is really the Wizard of Us. Thank you.
I told you your lives would be changed. So I invite you to pray with me if you so choose. As you open your hearts to this beautiful message, as you open your hearts to the possibilities of all of us, and we see within the frame that collective sense of love that loves us. I unify with that. I know you are one with that too. We are connected in profound and important ways. So I declare for each of us an opening, something that opens the door from the black and white to our technicolor, to the many possibilities, to the unlimited opportunities, to that which the divine provides all of us. That sense of courage, that sense of heart, that sense of knowing who we are. Thank you, God. And as I let go this word, I bless the opportunity and I welcome the possibility. So it is.